based in Lisbon. We are glad that we can be here and we would like to thank you for this opportunity to participate. The idea that we want to present today arose from the experience that we gained in our office, which apart from what conventionally could be considered as the architectural profession, includes the investigation and experiments on the use of raw materials like cardboard and cork in the contemporary design. We are performing these experiences under the CACO grant. The main principle of the CACO grant is the join of the materials from the traditional sector, which is the paper, which is cardboard and cork, and merge them with the advanced manufacturing methods. Basically, what we believe is that by joining what is traditional, what is considered to be craft, with the new technologies, we can arrive to the innovative solutions. And we don't think that they are necessarily in the opposition that it's normally considered to be. What we find interesting is that along the years and along with the evolution of the technology, we could observe a certain fear for the technology. And then later, as the answer towards that, we could also notice this kind of nostalgia in which we look to the craft. Probably the most visible moment where the fear for the technology appeared is the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, when the workers were basically afraid that the machines were to substitute them and then they would lose their jobs. And then after, with the appearing of the computers, with the extremely rapid evolution of the computer science, as a society, we started to be afraid that they can even take the control over the society. And then finally, as an architect, as much as we believe that, and it's obviously true that the new technologies can help us to solve the problems in the scale that it's impossible, that it used to be impossible before, and make our work more efficient, there is a group of us that are afraid that we, in that way, will start producing the forms that are kind of soulless, that they will lose their identity. And that, as an architect, designer, and in general as a society, makes us look back to the picture with this kind of sentiment, thinking that this is actually the true act of creation, because the man, by his personal touch, is giving the uniqueness to the piece that he's doing. And it seems that this spread all over, and the adjective handmade became something that can increase the sale of everything, because we want to have something that is crafted, because it's unique. But the question that we would like to ask is, what actually does it mean crafted these days, and what the craft means in our times? Because I think no one has a doubt that this man is a craftsman, any kind of person who dances in that way. Probably this one could be put in the same category. But then, when we look to that man, it seems that it's more difficult. And this is probably because of the tool that he's using, that is more elaborated, more sophisticated. But in fact, all of those men are using some kind of tool. It's just that the time has changed and the tool has changed as well. So we were trying to, for ourselves, define what actually is this thing that differentiates craft from other categories. And we took a brief overview on the history, and probably the most visible presence of the craft in the culture appears in the times of Enlightenment, when Diderot, writing his encyclopedia, describes all the processes and all the workshops and methods of how the things are getting done. But apart from describing the tools, the environment, he's basically describing the people that are working there. And what actually he was very glorifying was this attitude of the maker towards the thing that he's doing. He was fascinated with the struggle for sake of the good quality. And then John Ruskin later was also the initiator of the arts and craft movement. He was also fascinated by the vitality and the activity of the working class that he found in the opposition to the spoiled upper classes. So until now we could see that what makes it special is this relation that the creator has with the piece that he is doing. And then the other interesting point that appears is the beginning of the 20th century with the birth of the Deutsche Volksbund, when the idea of joining the industry, the craft, and the technology and the arts appears, and the idea that the mixture of those all can create new forms, create new values, and make them accessible to the more people. And the Gropius himself, in the manifesto of the Bauhaus School, he's calling for a new guild of craftsmen. And I think it's very significant that he, in the same text, is speaking about the humanistic technological culture. So for him, there is no such radical difference between what is technological and what is craft. He's putting those two things together. And then the other important adjective that always appears when you speak about craft is the knowledge and the skills that are involved in the process of doing. And the Oxford Dictionary, apart from the other definitions, gives this one, that actually the craft is the skill. The other very interesting point, and there are plenty of them, is the one given by David Pye in the book The Nature of and Art of Workmanship, in which he differentiate the craft from the other processes of doing by the factor of risk that is involved in the process of making. Because he's describing it as a process which is dynamic and in which the response comes from the material and it's not preliminary defined process and preliminary defined result. And the other thing that we found important in our way of thinking is that in the same he's somehow saying that the good material is a myth and that the good material itself doesn't exist because the thing that is making the material good is the process of treating them. So actually every material after treating can be valuable. And then finally Richard Sennett many times emphasize that actually what makes the craftsman so special is our saying. So summing up what we took from all this and what we find as the most important issues of craft is the involvement, the quality, the skills that are involved in the process, the mastering of the tool and the understanding of the material. And then the authenticity which comes from this risky, unpredictable process that makes output unit. Can we then speak about the digital craft? Can we then mix the technology and the craft in the same place? We believe that we can, because actually what the CAD/CAM technologies are allowing us to do is to experiment directly on the material, somehow giving us this possibility of getting the immediate response from the material instead of passing it through the paper, passing it then later to the factory and so on. And this is also what Matthias Kuhler is emphasizing very many times, speaking about the winery, the facade of the winery. He's emphasizing that in that case, the technology allowed him to control the process better because he could direct the process of construction directly from his computer. And then the other thing, that the other advantage is this possibility of customization and therefore fulfilling this wish of having something that was done especially for us as the clients in the case. So trying to take the advantage of this, we are of this qualities of digital fabrication, we are performing our experiences on these materials that I mentioned before under the CACO brand. And we developed several projects that Pedro is going to speak about.
Okay, then maybe the first thing that we would start with is the explain a bit the office. I know it's a bit out of the paper, but I think it's important to explain in a very short way with this slide. That we always struggle, we continue struggling in architecture, especially in the office, with this team of research. Our profession is mainly made by research, and it's very difficult to prove that we are doing research. So, and it's difficult to prove to academia, it's difficult to prove to industry, it's difficult to prove to clients. So it's not specific thing. So what we aim at, I know that it's very difficult and we are struggling with it, last 2 years, that's why a bit of the reason that we are here today, we are starting making research in a kind of more traditional way, more academic, trying to push what we are doing and transform it in academic research, so like 3 years ago. So Kaku Brand started in a kind of strange way, because we were asked to make a very, very fast thing for the stand of the Portuguese Agency of Environment, 2008. It was super, super fast. It was we not even knew very well the technology. This was a laser cut kind of thing. We made a very nice shape that we understood that it could be done in cardboard, so we picked a very fast and solution to do it, and also cheap. It was funny because they wanted a very easy that they could put it in and put it down as to many fairs that they would like to, but actually they, in the end of the day, they liked it so much that they became like kind of a sculpture on the wall of the APA. Another thing interesting on this process was that we had to build it ourselves. It's very easy just to put cardboard on top of each cardboard, but we had to make it ourselves because the client looked to it and said, well, we will never make it, even if you have the numbers. Please do it yourself, so we did it in the end, and resolved it with this. So this, from that one, we received another commission at Slow Bar in my hall. It was a bar, very easy bar again, so nothing special. The guys wanted to make a sustainable bar with selling things with the cork and carbon and another kind of materials that all about ecology. So we convinced them to make, okay, the bar is super easy, no really architecture, or not really nothing very special, but let's make just a feature, it was this one, a waved furniture that you could sit and you could expose the products and it could become also a bar. The guy liked it, he had money, he said, okay, well, we could do the second stand of APA, but this time with another technique and developing the beginning technique. So we started this time, okay, making with this steel things to compress. We tend to not use glue as much as possible. And then here it was with intersections. This was not laser cut, it was with a milling. And it was another kind of experience and we evolved. From here, we designed also, they didn't ask us, but we designed this kind of furniture. We also cover with the spares of the cardboard itself. And then the person asked us if we would sell it. So we thought, oh, why don't we make a brand and we start doing furniture? Which was also another very important thing on these three aspects of building projects and research, is that this is making design in small scale is what allows us to make in a very fast time, design it and produce it. Yep. It's of course our aim to make architecture takes 5, 6, 10 whatever years, and it's very difficult to make it fast. So this was a very interesting process. We made it ourselves as well, and this became the first object that we made in Kaku, so without the client. We designed it because we wanted to. So we make a rolling sofa that it's a sofa that actually can sit in two, that's why it's rolling in two sides. So it rolls. You see, in two sides, it can also stand and become a kind of a small panel. We have this vertical steel things again, so it's a very easy process. So you can sit on the two sides, as you can see. And we start developing in different ways, especially developing always with very poor materials. So what is interesting is, also, again, this kind of texture of the material and the impossibility of doing sophisticated things with a very poor material. This is cardboard, is a very poor material, and this is the prototype, very small prototype of the roll of cork. So we create a different material, and this is lamps. We have also some lamps. You use this for an installation that you made in your home. So this is the rolling, the three different positions, and the lamps again in cork. So the brand continue, and I think the interesting thing of this and what Kasia, well, related to what Kasia says, is that actually this becomes a very kind of craftsman thing, in the sense that we, of course, can customize it. We can industrialize it somehow, but it's not really mass production for sure. And when it is Azalea Bell, that actually some of you might know, that it won the prize of PAD in 2015, we decided to make the side beds, tables, and some lamps, and some other small products to the hotel itself. And it became one of the important things on the rooms, so everybody speaks about these core sites next to the room. So these small elements became also again incorporated in our practice and what we do. This is Oceanari, which is of course one of the most known buildings of the office. We didn't produce anything in CAD/CAM. The most close that we managed was this this thing of the facade. And what we aim on this process is actually to go further from the design as possible and try to go to the buildings. And that's our aim, of course, I know it's super difficult. But we are at this moment developing a kind of study and research on these ceramic two-dimensional things. Also because this aspect that we developed the facade specific to this building, we had a very close relation with the industry itself, because it was a very small industry now that is in Barcelona, and that they actually we built up this facade together, and it was customized. It was very technical, very computer directed. We made several drawings and devices, especially in 3D. I'm not going to make it long because this was not the object of this lecture, but what I think is interesting, and I finish like this, is that in the end, part of the pieces were made by hand.